The playable characters of Super Mario Bros. 2 have such special eyes. Mario's iconic late NES-era sprite design is filled in with his white eyes that pop out from his orange skin color, something the Super Mario Bros. 1 sprite lacks. Luigi's skinnier eye whites fit to the shape of his more oval-shaped head and taller overall build. And the princess's eyes may look odd when you first look at them in detail, but from afar you can see these three brown pixels emerge as eyelashes and eyeliner. Toad's eyes? Well, Toad's eyes are just two blue rectangles, but he's basically just a blue super mushroom with a body, so the simplification is warranted. Everyone's eyes may look gorgeous, but the way they were implemented in the NES's architecture was gorgeous too. The developers responsible for reskinning Doki Doki Panic into Super Mario Bros. 2 went through extra effort to get these sprites to look like this, so let's take a deeper look. Graphics on the Nintendo Entertainment System have a bit depth of 2 bits per pixel. This means each pixel is encoded with 2 bits. This allows for up to 4 different colors per tile. In the case of objects, 00 is treated as transparent, so really there are only 3 colors left. So if you look at Toad's sprite here, there's blue, white, and orange. Same goes for the other characters. Mario here has blue, red, orange, and white. Never mind that. Luigi has blue, green, tan, and... well, Princess Toadstool has brown, pink, and tan. Oh, and white too. How is this even possible? Well, like I said, it's 3 colors plus transparency for each object. Sprites like these are often made up of multiple objects, and here is no exception. Each character is made up of 4 8x16 objects, or so it seems on the surface. Everyone but Toad has white eyes, which exceeds the maximum number of colors per object. Therefore, an extra object is used specifically for the whites of their eyes. The main graphics for each character just has transparent eyes, which acts like a cardboard cutout so you can see the smaller white object underneath. Actually, Toad uses an extra object as well, you just can't see it because his eyes aren't transparent, and even then, the extra object is just completely transparent and has no white on it at all anyway. It's worth pointing out here that the player sprites in Doki Doki Panic don't have special eyes. Each character uses up to only 4 objects at any time. It's the updated sprites in Mario 2 that use 5. This means an additional object had to be drawn to the screen. This wasn't just a simple graphics swap. Let's take a short moment to see how object data are stored in the NES's picture processing unit. Object attribute memory, or OAM, is a small section of memory just 256 bytes large that holds all of the necessary information the PPU needs to draw objects to the screen. It can hold up to 64 objects data, since each object uses 4 bytes, the object's X and Y position, tile ID, and extra attributes such as palette, background priority, and horizontal or vertical flipping. Oftentimes, developers will reserve certain indices into the OAM table for certain gameplay elements. For example, in Doki Doki Panic, the 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th entries are reserved for holding data for the 4 objects that make up the player sprite. The rest of OAM is partitioned out for other uses as well. More notably, there are 9 sets of 4 objects that are handed out to each of the currently loaded enemies and items. So while the NES has the hardware limit of 64 objects to display at one time, this extra software layer created by the developers limits this to 9 sprites that can use up to 4 objects each, plus some extra for the player and higher priority entities. For example, a Shy Guy only uses up 2 of the 4 objects in one set, so the other 2 will go unused and can't be used for another enemy or item. Things that use up more than 4 objects can be allotted more than one set as well, like this explosion graphic and most of the bosses in the game. So where does the new single object for the character's eyes get inserted into all of this? It's part of the player sprite, so it'd be nice if it were up here next to the rest of the player objects. But that would require shifting things around, and that becomes a lot of work. So instead, in Super Mario Bros. 2, one of the 9 sets of objects gets assigned to hold this object, while the other 3 in the set become unused. This essentially reduces the number of available sprites to be drawn to the screen from 9 to 8. If there are not enough empty sets of objects available to display all of the sprites on screen, they will begin to flicker as only 9 sets can be shown during any single frame at a time. That's actually another thing I wanted to bring up in this video. In this situation, the extra sprite or sprites that can't fit into OAM aren't drawn for that frame. Which sprite becomes this candidate is shuffled around each frame. This way, one of the enemies or items doesn't just turn invisible for a brief moment, which would be unfair to the player. Instead, they flicker. If a sprite is only visible 8 out of every 9 frames, it will still be mostly visible, since it's only invisible for one frame at a time. It's just that now a bunch of sprites are affected instead of just one. And in fact, this strategy of shuffling objects around in OAM is used for another purpose as well. If two objects overlap on top of one another, whichever one has the lowest slot index will be drawn. This is good for making sure certain things are always visible. In this example, the objects that make up the player are allotted near the top of OAM, so the player will always show up in front of enemies and items. And there are a few more reserved OAM slots for other objects that may need to appear on top of the player, such as the sprite the player is holding, doors, and the mask gate. However, this priority system can cause issues when two sprites intersect, but one shouldn't necessarily be covering the other one up. Let's say two enemies are walking past one another. One doesn't really deserve to always be on top of the other. So to be fair and allow both enemies to show through, the OAM slots that each sprite gets is shuffled every frame. So sometimes one sprite will be on top, and sometimes it will be underneath. At full speed, this creates a flickering effect. The NES doesn't have any sort of partial transparency, so this is as good as you'll get. And since all of the object sets are shuffled, this works even if three or more things overlap. And this is why only Mario, Luigi, and the princess's eyes will twinkle when they go through a door. During the door opening animation, the door sprite takes up two sets of objects in OAM. While the four objects that make up the majority of the character sprite are hard-coded to always be on top, the extra white object for their eyes is shuffled around along with the door sprite. So sometimes the door sprites are behind the character, but in front of their eyes, causing them to turn door-colored. This happens with any objects in the shuffled section of OAM, not just doors. It's just easier to notice here because everything is stationary. Just for fun, here is a short clip of the game with the true OAM slots that are used by each sprite. Here you can see just how wild the shuffling around is. You can also see that all of the OAM slots are shuffled every frame, even if nothing is in them. This simplifies the algorithm that allocates object sets to OAM. Thank you for watching. If you're interested in chatting with other people who like learning about the insides of retro video games, this is another reminder that Retro Game Mechanics Explained has a Discord server. I recently added a handful of casual discussion channels so you can talk about whatever. You can find an invite link to it in the description of this video.